Good morning, students. Today we are going to discuss about arrays. So in my last class we had discussed, I had given you a brief introduction of data structures, its types and its classification. So today, from today we are going to start with arrays. So it is a part of the first unit. Array is a part of the first unit. So in unit 1, basically we are going to talk about data and information. We are going to talk about classification of data structures, abstract data types and memory representation of data structures. So in the first unit, basically we will talk about two linear data structures. As I told you in the last class, we have linear and non-linear data structures. So in the first unit, we are going to talk about arrays and linked lists, their representation in memory. We are going to talk about insertion, deletion, some basic operations on arrays and linked lists, and I'm also going to talk about applications of arrays and linked lists, types of linked lists. So students, let us start today's lecture and first discuss the first topic in unit 1, which is data and information. So as you all know, there is a very subtle difference between data and information. Data are the facts or details from which information is derived. So when I talk about data, data is just nothing but some facts or some collection of information, some collection of maybe numbers or some statistics without from which we cannot draw any inference. When we perform some processing, we process this data, then it becomes information. That means basically when I process the data and try to derive some conclusion or some inference, then I call that data as information. So as you all know, that individual pieces of data are rarely useful alone, because they are just pieces of data. They are of no use to us. For data to become information, it needs to be put into context. So when I need to put it into context, I need to process that data. So as here I have given you the definition of both data and information. So I will read out the definition. Data is raw, unorganized facts that need to be processed. It can be something simple and seemingly random and useless until it is organized. So data is nothing but it is raw, unorganized facts, and it is simply random, useless information, and it is of no use until and unless it is organized. While information is data which is processed, organized, structured or presented in a given context so as to make it useful. So whenever we process that data, we organize it, we structure it and we present it in a certain context, then we say that that data is information. We call that as information. For example, let us take an example that each student's test score, if I talk about every student's test score in a class, then it is just piece of data. But if I talk about average score of a class or of the entire school, then I say that this is information. See, if I say, if you have a subject like maths, and if I say that 60 students are there in your class, and I say that roll number 1 has scored 50 marks, roll number 2 has scored 75 marks, 3 has scored 86 marks, 4, so it is of no information to you. But if I say that the average score of CS third sem students in maths is 75%, then you know that most of the students have scored around 75% or near about 75%. So you are able to draw some inference from that information. So whenever we process raw data, we always convert it into information, because we are able to draw some conclusion or information or some conclusion or inference from that. Now let us come to what are abstract data types, because we are talking about data structures, we are talking about data types, types of data that we are going to structure. We will also talk about a very commonly used term which is known as abstract data type. Now in case of abstract data type, it is a type or class for objects whose behavior is defined by a set of value and a set of operations. So we will say that any abstract data type, it is for a, when it is defining the behavior of objects in terms of value or a set of operations. Now basically why we call it abstract is because you don't know the details what are inside that abstract data type. So if I say that this data type is going to accept this value, and these are the set of operations you can perform on that data type. Now you are not bothered about how these operations are implemented within the data type. So the definition of abstract data type only mentions what operations are to be performed, but not how these operations will be implemented. So basically abstract data type, it acts like a black box because you don't know what is inside it. It does not specify how data will be organized in memory and what algorithms will be used for implementing the operations. So every data type that you are going to study, every data structure, whether we talk about arrays, linked lists, we are going to talk about stacks, you will see that for a layman, it's an abstract data type. So we always say array is an abstract data type because as a user, I am only going to use the interface or the abstraction where I am bothered only about the kind of values it is going to accept and the set of operations that I can perform on it. But I am not bothered about the other details. But as computer science engineers, we are also going to talk about the implementation details. So I can say that it is called abstract because it gives an implementation independent view. We are not bothered about the implementation, so it is an implementation independent view. The process of providing only the essentials and hiding the details is known as abstraction. And that is why the term abstraction, because of this word abstraction, the term abstract data types arises. So user of a data type need not know how that data type is implemented. For example, you have been using data types like integer, float, character data. You know that the kind of values they accept and what you can do with those values. But you don't know how these values are stored or implemented in memory. So a user only needs to know what a data type can do, but now not how it will do it. And that is why I say that ADT is a black box which hides the inner structure and design of the data type. Now let us come to arrays. Now whenever I will say array is an abstract data type, because hum jab usko dekhenge, as a user we are not going to deal with the implementation, but as a computer science engineer in your data structures course you are also going to talk about the implementation of the operations that you are going to perform on the data structure, which is right now array. So array is a data structure that represents a collection of the same types of data. Maine last class mein bhi aapko bataya tha, it is a collection of homogeneous elements or same type of data. That means if I have, for example, here in this slide, I have defined array double. Okay, double is the type of the array and the name of the array is mylist is equal to new double 10. That means this array is a new double, name of the array is new double, and new double is the size of new double is 10. That means it can hold 10 elements and the type is double. Double means floating point numbers which are having a big length, they are known as double. So double is the data type, mylist is the name of the array, and we have assigned or initialized that array with the help of new double 10. So it is going to hold 10 elements. Now arrays, as you can know, you can define them or you can call it a container which can hold fixed number of items, and these items should be of the same type. Okay? Most of the data structures, it is a very very important data structure because most of the data structure make use of arrays to implement their algorithms. So there are some important terms and concepts of arrays that we are going to study. First of all, element and index. Element is each item which is stored in an array, that is why it is called as an element. So every item that is stored in an array is called as an element, and every item has a location in the array. So that location we are going to represent it with the help of a numerical index, and it is used to identify the element. Now arrays can be declared in various ways in different languages. So in this class we are going to see the various ways in which we can declare the arrays. So I am going to show you various ways to declare an array. So this is the first which you can see on your slide. This is the first method of declaring an array, and as you can see I have said integer array and in square brackets I have given a number 10. Now this 10 indicates that the size of this array, the name of which is array, is 10, and the type of elements that it is going to hold is integer. So in the first I have given the int is indicating that array can hold elements of type integer. The size of array is 10, and these are the after equal to, I have assigned the 10 values to this array. So this is one method of declaring an array. There are other methods also. This is on your slide, you can see other way of declaring. So data type square bracket array name. Example is, like for example, double square bracket my list. Now in this square bracket I have not assigned a number. So when you don't assign a number, but when you run your program, so whatever values you assign to this my list, that number of values will define the size of my list. So you can declare the size at the time of declaration, or at the runtime your array can take a size. So whenever your array takes a size at runtime, we call that array as dynamic array. And when at the time of declaration I fix the size of the array, it is known as a static array. Okay, now this is another method of creating an array. Array name is equal to new data type and array size. Example is given in the slide. My list is equal to new double 10. With new you can create an array. New is a word which is, it is a reserved word which is used to create an array. So new double and the size of that is 10. So here I have, see, my list 0 references the first element in the array, my list 9 references the last element in the array. So students, you have to keep in mind, if the size of the array is given as 10, then the array can hold 10 elements and the index of the array will vary from 0 to 9. Okay, now this is a shortcut declaring and creating in one step. So data type square bracket, where you can define the size, array name is equal to new data type array size. So in the next step I have given an example, double my list is equal to new double 10. Okay, so this is another method of declaring and creating an array together in one step. Okay, now once an array is created, its size is fixed, it cannot be changed. You can find its size. Suppose I am creating a large project, and in the beginning of the project I have defined an array with a particular length. Now the size of the array is fixed, but later on, maybe after developing a large number of code, huge amount of code, I forget that array I had defined, what was the length of that array. So any point in my program I can use this command, array variable dot length. For example, I had in the previous slide I had created an array my list. So if I write down my list dot length, it will return a value of 10, because if you will remember, in my last slide I had created my list as an array, and the size of that array was 10. So anytime, any point in your program, if you forget the length of your array, you just have to give the name of the array followed by a dot sign and followed by length. So it returns the size of the array. Now if I come to initializing arrays, I can initialize arrays, like for example here, if you can see in the second line, I have initialized in one step, double my list is equal to 1.9, 2.9, 3.4, 3.5. So I have assigned 4 values to my list, and I have initialized, created and declared in one step only. But if the number of elements are more, I cannot use this method. For that I will have to use a loop statement. So for initializing arrays and for assigning values into that array, we use a for loop. Okay, so in my slide you can see the syntax for that. For integer I varying from 0, I is the index of the array which will start from 0, it will be just less than my length, my list dot length. So if it returns a my list dot length is value is 10, then I will be less than 10, I will be incremented at each step, and my list I is equal to item. So here I have declared, I have created, and I have also initialized the array by assigning values. So every time the loop works, at every time I initially I will be 0, so my list 0, you will hold some, give it some value, then I will be incremented by 1, so my list 1 will be assigned a value, on and so on. So with the help of the loop you can assign values to any array of any length. Okay, now this is another shorthand notation which is equivalent to the following statement. So these are the various ways in which you can declare, create and initialize your arrays. So these are all various methods in this class. Totally, basically, I have talked about how you are going to declare your arrays. Okay. So in this lecture, the important points that you have to keep in mind is that always the index of an array starts with a zero. If I say that the length of the array is 8, it means it can hold 8 elements, and each element can be accessed via its index. So if I want to review this lecture before I end it, basically we had talked about data, we have talked about information, we have talked about abstract data types, and we have talked about the various ways in which we can declare, create and initialize the arrays. So in the next class, we are going to talk about the memory representation of arrays. Till then, take care, students, and thank you so much.